Lord, he's carrying us on the offings, and we may rise above of the storm. It's not by flying away, but by coming away. It's not by one, but by a big ever sun.
Understanding and a perception Perception's everything in the kingdom. Perception means everything in the kingdom of God. And he told Abraham, lift up your eyes and look. Before he could ever, before he was ever instructed to walk around. Remember there? He said, lift up your eyes and see. First he said, look at the stars in the heaven. Look at the sand on the earth. He's trying to give him something. There's no way you can count.
That's right.
Or put a limit on the promise of God. There's no way you can box in the promises of God. Hallelujah. And it's not, I mean, even on a qualification or a disqualification basis. But they really don't depend on you. He fulfilled it all in himself.
Yes.
Now you're just the seed of Abraham.
Amen.
Yea, my will for you and my desire to bless you over and above all things has never been in question, says the Lord. I've always stood in man with my hand open, just waiting for him to receive. But now as your eyes are open and there's strength to begin to go on a walkabout tour of what I've accomplished in my Son Jesus Christ, now you shall not just see, but you will hold out your hands too to receive, says the Lord. And there won't be a delay or a hesitation. For the moment you open your hand, you'll notice that my hands have always been open in your direction. And grace has provided this thing for you, says the Lord. It's not. There's one thing, there's a concept there in that chapter of Abraham that I've grown to just adapt to, so to say. That your feet will never take you where your mind's never been.
That's true. That's the truth.
If you've never seen it, it's hard for you to go on a walkabout tour of it. But see, this thing, he says, lo, I come and I do a quick work. So he's not in the business of showing you something and then waiting 20 years down the road for you to actually. Because it's not fulfilled that way. God, you know, God don't work on a calendar.
That's right.
He's not bound to all that stuff. So the question's never been and never will be, is it the will of God for you to be healed? Is it the will of God for you to prosper? Is it the will of God, come on, for your kids to prosper? Is it, you know, we hear it all the time, you know, especially in prayer when it comes from something to somebody. Lord, if it be thy will. I was to the radio station the other day. It was a Christian radio station, and it's hard to listen to sometimes. It's a popular one. You know what I mean? And don't get me, there's good songs. But if you just sat back and listened to some of the songs, you'd probably do better just to change it to some old honky tonk station or something like that. Because there's no life kind of coming out of it. And they have these times during the day where they pray, and especially if there's something that's, you know, been drawn to their attention, right? And it started out, Lord, if it's your will, if it be your will, heal this person. Not even knowing the heart of the Father. Good people, folks. Very sincere in their love for God. But don't really know the heart of God. So they have this mindset, well, if it be, you know, there in the garden scene, remember at the Last Supper, which would be the Last Supper for the first Adam. Glory be to God. It'd be his last meal. And he took that cup, and he drank that cup. Why did he drink that cup? Because everything that was represented in that cup was killing man. So he was taking it upon himself. So everything in that cup would be what would cause him to die. One of the things that caused man to die was, if it be thy will, O Lord. So he makes that announcement in the garden. The whole thing with Peter and the denial. Man denying his true origin. Man denying his true existence and all that stuff. All those things. He says, it's not going to kill you any longer. I'm going to take it. But I'm going to get, and he told him, you're going to drink with me anew. There's going to be something new that you're going to drink. You'll never have to drink of that old system any longer, of that old way of thinking anymore. And what happens is, as our mind and our perception has changed on this, there's an immediate, just as when Jesus, you remember when he told them to go ahead and go to the other side? This wasn't the time that he got on the boat with them. He told them, go to the other side. I'm going to go up on the mountain and pray. And remember, they start on the other side, and it says there came a wind that was contrary to them. Or a doctrine that was contrary to them. Remember, tossed about by winds of doctrine. And they start rowing, trying to make it. And can't go nowhere. The minute they stop rowing, they see Jesus walking on the water. Now think about that. They would have seen him a lot sooner if they would have stopped rowing a lot sooner. You see, the rowing speaks of toil and sweat. You trying to get to the other side by your own effort rather than just not being tossed about by everything that comes around that tries to tell you, no, you got to do this in order for that to happen, and you got to be like this in order for that to happen. And the thing is when they said, Lord, is that you? Because they seen him in a new dimension, and they seen him in a new way that they did not see on the shore. They couldn't recognize him. He came in his true form, his true existence, a spirit. And Peter said, Lord, is that you? And he says, it is I. Do you know, literally in that Greek, it means he says, I am. He always referred to himself in that. Not I'm going to be. Not I was one day. No, my past is my friend. But the right nowness of God. Yeah. And it says that when they received him in to the ship, that immediately they was on the other side. Yeah. In other words, he didn't get in the ship, pull out the old trolling motor, and they just put it along. Yeah. But the minute they received him as he is, immediately they was at their destiny. Hallelujah. And that's the power of the now of God. That the moment, there's always that moment, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, or in a bat of an eye. Hallelujah. You're going to be changed. Changed from what? The way you used to think. The way you used to see things. And in that moment of just simply seeing something, oh, glory be to God, you're caught up with it. You're raptured with it. You see no separation. And that's what, glory be to God, this thing is all about, is that because anywhere you look at it, when any metal is put in the fire, it never does away with the metal. It only reveals the metal. You know, you take gold and you put it in the fire, what are you going to get out of it? Gold. Yeah. The fire is going to reveal the gold. Yeah. And that's anything that approaches you, anything that you walk through is going to reveal the Christ on the inside of you. Well, glory be to God. Happy to be here. Yeah. Happy to go into this fourth chapter of Ruth. Yeah. Then I realized that I'll be here Sunday morning too, so I don't have to hurry. We can just walk through this thing. Amen. Well, I think we got one usher, JJ. Oh, Brenna. This is Brenna's 16th birthday Eve. God bless you guys that have the give. And you know why? I don't say those that don't have, because I don't even see it that way anymore. every one of you have something to give. Amen. God bless you. Received the 6 to go with a 1, right? Yes. Make 7. Yes. And in the dawning of a new day, she heads towards Naomi, and Naomi can't recognize her because she's been in the presence of Boaz. And hallelujah. That ought to be, you know, maybe when you see me in my beginning, you had a certain judgment of me. But to see me in my conclusion, you know what I mean? Hallelujah. I want to have that glow. Which we find out, we're finding out that it's always there. Yeah. Always been there. This is the revelation or the unveiling of Jesus Christ. You know what I mean? So we're not talking about, I believe Matt used it one time, an illustration. You know, when they went in any kind of sculpture or whatsoever, I mean, Mount Rushmore, if you want to use that, or the Statue of David, you know what I mean? And you think about that, they grab this huge piece of rock. And Michelangelo takes it to this old shack, and he goes in this shack, and he begins to come forth with the Statue of David in that. Now, where did that begin? First of all, it began in his head. An image. He had to have an image of this. But do you understand that he didn't take that image and glue it on that rock and say, there it is. But he just began to pull away piece by piece and just chisel and chisel away. Because why? The image. Come on. That statue was already there all along. It just had to, what was covering it just had to be removed out. So when we talk about the revelation of Jesus Christ, we're talking about the uncovering. It's not the creation of Jesus Christ. It's the uncovering of Christ. It's just simply pulling this out of the way. This false image out of the way. This lie out of the way. One at a time. And sometimes it comes in such a swoop that this ain't like he just took a whole big chunk and pulled away. And so now we know. See how I get on these things? Hallelujah. Now we know that the image is Jesus. See, Jesus is the image. It's when God thought of man and thinks of him in his mind, Jesus gives substance to that. So we know what it's going to look like and what it's going to sound like. You know what I'm saying? And that's why we relate to it, because he was an example for us. He was an example of us. Big difference in thinking. Because if you think he was an example for you, you will tire yourself out, man. Trying to be like Jesus. You know, what would Jesus do? You know what I mean? You got wristbands and all kinds of stuff over that. But see, we're not talking about Jesus running out, and I use this a lot. We're not about Jesus running over here, you know, and us over here, and he's on one side of the shore, and we're on the other side, and we're looking over there, and we're trying to see him and then try to match what he's doing. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that's an example for us. But we're looking straight in a mirror, man. I mean, and we look in that mirror, and the only thing the mirror can reflect is what's standing in front of it. In its completeness, in its entirety. So you can't grow any more complete, but what you can grow in is in your understanding of how complete you are in him. And so the day when it comes for the unveiling of the statue of David, Michelangelo calls a big town meeting, and they all come there. And he's got this sheet covering it, you know. And guess what? When it comes time to unveil it, he doesn't have a hammer in his hand. He doesn't have a chisel in his hand anymore. Because who in the world would want to come see that? It's the unveiling day. It's the unveiling of what's perfected, of what's complete. So there's not a sound of a hammer heard. Ooh, hallelujah. It's just simply him pulling the veil out of the way, and there stands that beautiful completed work called the Statue of David. And see, where we've kind of got, especially fundamentally and with Pentecost in that way of thinking, we think that all the bad things that come in our path, so to say, not really in our path, but how many of us there, the monkeys and dragons that are on the side just trying to get your attention, you know what I'm saying? But what we've did is we've used all that to say, well, that's how God's molding and making me into what I need to be. But see, back in Solomon's temple, when it come time to place that stone in the temple, there was not a sound of a hammer coming. Because all the hammering had been done in the quarry. Now what we tried to do is give the circumstances and the storms and all that, made that the quarry. But that's not the quarry. Jesus Christ is the quarry. All the hammering that ever needed to be done was done in him. So you don't need to know or think that God is using hell to bring forth heaven in your life. You don't have to think that, you know, the two flat tires you've had this week or, you know, the kids running around crazy or whatever it is, you know what I'm saying? I mean, that you walk through to think that that's what God's employing to bring about perfection in your life. No. He put you in the one that is so complete. And he said you're fully represented in him. Without need of a hammer. Woo! Without need of a chisel. Glory be to God. And that's what it is. This is, see, we're going to get to the end. It's your unveiling day. For hallelujah. For everything that has tried to bring an identity to you that's really not who you are. And see, that's what the gospel is. The gospel, how beautiful are the feet of them who come with a salvation message that says that God in Jesus Christ has rescued you from every lie that you've had to believe about yourself or anybody else. So when we get through in this teaching, and we do this teaching, we're not trying to hammer anything out of you. All we're trying to do is just remove anything. Hallelujah. Any thought, any image. Hallelujah. Any way you thought of a past experience. You know, sometimes you need to go revisit them things and correct the way you thought. That's the truth. Go back and say, no, I know order was there. I know peace was there. I know mercy was there. All that other stuff was just a suggestion. And we let it in the door, thinking it may give us some glory. Give us a name. I got a good one for you. Give you a testimony. Huh? What greater testimony could you ever have that you began in God? And no suggestion that this world offers could ever change that. You know what I'm saying? I mean, the thing is, we go... Say it like this. 17 years I spent where I was never a broken vessel. Now in my mind, I might have seen myself that way. But see, mercy looks through every bit of it. And it sees that which cannot change, and it cannot be altered, and it cannot be corrupted, and it cannot be marred, and it cannot, oh, hallelujah. And it just looks and gazes into that. And no wonder the whole time, you know what I'm saying? You know, he said, that's why he says, if you make your bed in hell, guess what? I've already beat you there. And he didn't come there to lay beside you and wait for you to get up. You know what I'm saying? Nor did he come there to look you in the face and say, you old dirty, rotten scoundrel, I told you 5 years ago, if you didn't do this, this is what's going to happen to you. No, he come to tell you exactly who you are.
That's right.
Come and tell you, I've never went to sleep. I've never fainted. I've never grown weary. The truth about you has never altered itself one bit. And I'm just here to tell you exactly who you are. And I'm not waiting for you to embrace me. I'm going to go ahead and embrace you. You don't have to include me in your circle because I'm going to make the circle so big. And everybody's included in it. Well, Ruth, my. Lord. Verse 16, chapter 3. Let's look at this. And when she came to her mother-in-law, she said, who art thou, my daughter? That's not Naomi speaking. And she told her all that the man had done to her. She said, these 6 measures of barley gave he me, for he said to me, go not empty. Listen to that. This is Boaz speaking. Go not empty unto my mother-in-law. Let me give you a heavy revy right off the top. If you ain't going empty, you're going full. You ain't going empty, you're going full. Full of joy, full of peace, full of the blessing of the Lord, that you can bless others. Hallelujah. You can cause others to see the same goodness of God that you see. You see, that's what she's coming with. She's coming with not just a message about all that he did for her in the threshing floor, but she's got evidence of it. She's carrying that bag of barley right there with her. Oh, it's undeniable. It's unquestionable. So many times you hear of Stephen and Paul and all them that would raise up and begin to say stuff, especially with Stephen, the whole couple chapters there in Acts, how what he said was undebatable. With all the wisdom of the Sadducees and the Pharisees and all them there, they could not debate the truth that this man began to, woo, hallelujah, begin to say. So, go not empty unto thy mother-in-law. Then she said, This is Naomi talking to Ruth. Sit still, my daughter, until thou know how the matter will fall, for the man will not be in rest until he hath finished the thing this day. Now remember, glory be to God. We talked about the other night the Levirate law of marriage. It's found in Deuteronomy chapter 25. You start about verse 5. I'm not going to read all of it. But the gist of it, and I explained it the other night, but we'll do it again just because you know. That's what she's talking about. Everything required for your redemption, you can rest. Because he won't rest until it's completely done. Woo, hallelujah. Glory be to God. He had told her before that all that thou do, I'll perform it. He said that back in chapter 3. He said that, hallelujah, that the part that needed to be done in the kinsman, for the kinsman redeemer, everything that needed to be done, I'll perform. So many scriptures ought to just pop in your mind right now where, you know what I'm saying, that he that hath begun a good work in you shall perform it unto the end. You know what I'm saying? I mean, oh, hallelujah to God. See, we've got this concept of God that God wants to meet us halfway. So he's going to exercise his faith just halfway and then wait for you to come meet him halfway. That ain't how it works. He come to show, give everything he believed about you in Jesus Christ. He is the substance of the faith of God. What God believes, what God's had in mind all along. Even when he flung the stars out, you know what I mean? It was called this thought. I mean, sometimes we don't grasp that you are the reason that the stars light up the night, that the wind blows wherever it goes, hallelujah, that the rivers run, and the rain comes to the dry ground, and all this takes place because he had you on his mind. You're the very thought that inspired all of everything. Hallelujah. And so she says, just sit still. Sit in peace. Because everything that has to be done to complete your redemption, he will do it. Now let me give you another story like that. In Esther chapter 7, verse 10. There is a scripture that says that the king, speaking of King Xerxes, would not be at rest, or he wouldn't be pacified until Haman was crucified. Now, whether you want to put Haman as a type of the flesh or a type of the devil, it doesn't really matter. What matters is that he would not be satisfied until that old guilt, accusing system, accusation was put completely to death. Moved out of the way. So he what? Spoiled principalities and powers? And thanks be to God, he didn't go to a back corner somewhere. So only a few would know what happened. But it says he made a show of it, what? Openly. Openly. On that cross is every accusation against man that could possibly make you feel distant from God, separated from God, worthy of punishment from God. Every accusation is there, completely canceled out, completely done away. And he did it on the... Go read Romans chapter 3, I think it's 3, maybe the end of 3 in the Message Bible. It says that he did it on the altar of the world. Wow, what a statement. The only altar call that ever had any relevance to it, he answered it on behalf Now they'd never have to come to the brazen altar again. But they could without shame come boldly to the throne of grace. What are we talking about here? We're talking about coming into the most holy place, which is what? The immediate presence of God. The immediate, tangible, always knowing, constant there. That's what I've asked Lord, more than just giving me these hours of bliss, you know what I'm saying? Take me into that constant thing. Oh, hallelujah. Well, that don't even have to be a lot of words said. Not even a whole lot of hallelujahs, just aware that I'm in the immediate presence of mercy and the immediate presence of peace and the immediate presence of joy. Oh, and it's everything's at my disposal, just right there. You know what I'm saying? I mean, to call upon, to receive, to give, which is where the roadblock usually is. Come on. Is giving it when it don't look like it should happen, or like, you know what I mean, or they deserve it, you know what I mean? And remember the story about the guy that owed the king all this money, and the king showed him mercy, and God went right out to the first guy that owed him money less than what he even owed the king to begin with, and he started beating up on him, you know, and the guy, the servant of the king, said, you know the story, they went off, and he had to live according to his own judgment. So here we have Haman and Esther completely done away with. That's why, it's really a benefit for you and I to know the word devil means the accuser. Remember in the story of the woman caught in adultery when everybody posted it on Facebook, right? Everybody put it on social media. I mean, it was there, you know. We got proof. Call in it, you know. Look, gotta be real. It's on Facebook. You know? Must be real. We got it. And when they're in that setting there, and he says, "Woman, where are thou accusers?" You know, it's the same word that's translated devil. Translated devil. And when you think about there in John where he says, "I come to destroy the works of the devil," it's the word diablo. Dia means through. You know what ablo means? The fall. In other words, he came to destroy anything that came, any lie that came through the fall. It wasn't about a pitchfork, God, something. It was every lie that man believed about himself. He comes and destroys. So this is what Naomi's communicating. You just sit and rest. You just sit in peace. You just go lay down. Because every lie that came through, every way of thinking that came through that flame, he will not rest until it's completely removed out of it. Completely removed out of it. So that brings us here to chapter 4. Then went Boaz up to the gate and sat him down there, and behold, the kinsman of whom Boaz spake came by, unto whom he said, "Ho, such a one, turn aside, sit down here." And he turned aside and he sat down. So, we got a picture of Boaz ascending up, sitting down at the gate. And that gate, the gate spoke of a place of authority. The throne. What they did was, everybody that was anybody in the city that had any kind of power, authority, or anything, they would all meet at the gate. And they would sit at the gate, and it was at that place that judicial decisions were made, where things were made legal, binding. Where things were brought into existence that could not change. where words were established.
Yes.
And so the picture is there because Boaz is a type of Jesus. So we're looking at Jesus ascending and sitting down at the right hand of the Father. Now hold your place there in Ruth. Go to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 1. Here's what it says. You there? Verse 1. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, what did he do? Sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. You understand? Him sitting down is the announcement that mankind is completely innocent. The whole basis of his authority is governed by man's innocence. Man being completely restored to their pre-Adamic innocence with him. That means transparency, folks. That means never in a place where you're feeling suspicious, feeling blame, feeling guilt, feeling condemnation, feeling anything coming from God, because it was never there to begin with. See, the sacrifice wasn't to appease God. When God clothed Adam, it wasn't to change the way God seen Adam. It was to change the way Adam seen about himself. God never had an issue. He never had an issue with his nakedness.
Oh, glory be to God.
So, you remember in the old covenant, in the old system of doing things, there had to be a sacrifice daily. There had to be an offering daily for the remission of sins. And what did that do? That only brought awareness to sin. Because even on that great day, and you gotta understand, here are these people, they're living, you would say, some at their best, others not. You know? Some of them are probably getting it that it's impossible for them to run through these rules, you know what I'm saying, and make it. But here you got these sacrifices going on daily, but there's going to be one time a year that there's going to be this whole sacrificial system with, you know, 13 this one, then the next day 12, and then 10, you know what I mean, and they just run all down, and, I mean, and it's the Feast of Tabernacles and the Day of Atonement, the eighth day in that feast. And on this day can one man, he's going to enter in into the most holy place, but he's not going to go in without blood. He's going in, contrary to what we've always taught, he didn't have a rope tied around us. There's no scripture in there that says that there was a rope tied around us. The only thing that went in him that day was the voice of the blood, folks. That was it. There was a thriller. Ooh-wee. So he goes in there, and in type and shadow, he goes in there for a whole nation. As a whole nation. The stones on the breastplate, the onyx stones, all that stuff. There's 12 there, you know what I'm saying? There's 6 here, 6 there, there's 12 more out here. All that is about him carrying a whole nation in there, whether they believed in that system or not. Were they adhered to it or not? He's going in that one day for that. But the problem with that system is he couldn't stay in there. Because The day after the Day of Atonement, guess what he had to do? Go right back out. Start sacrificing again. So all it did was just bring a remembrance. Sin. Almost sounds like Pentecost system. Well, the only thing we bring up is what you don't need to do or what you do need to do. Rather than what he did. Because everything hinges from the third to the fourth chapter on what he did. On what he accomplished. What he set out to do. But see, now in this Melchizedek order, there was one sacrifice made. Never have to be another one made. He never has to come out of the most holy place to go visit the brazen altar again, to die again, and to die over and over and over again on a daily thing, because he went in and he forever cleansed. Every item in that most holy place. And when he gets done announcing that man is completely innocent, no trace of guilt, no sense of condemnation, even when Paul said, even when I want to do it and I don't do it, or I don't want to do it and I do it anyway. He said, what is the conclusion of the matter? There is no condemnation. In Christ Jesus. Because he stands there as a complete representative. Whole thing. So he goes in. And he speaks this language. But this time, unlike any other priest, they had to come right back out. And deal with the same deal over and over and over again. He goes and he sits down. From this point, he announces, man will never be guilty. Never feel guilty. Never have to feel unworthy. Excluded. Left out. Not fit. No matter where they're. I don't care right now if they've been up for 5 days. Do you know in the mind of God, they sit with him in the most holy place? When I sat down, I didn't sit down alone, says the Lord. Neither did I just sit down with a handful here and there, but I wrapped my arms around all of humanity. And they sat down with me. Now from this seated position shall my glory fill this earth. And every eye shall see, and every ear shall hear, and every knee shall bow to this truth, says the Lord. You see, Paul says that we're stewards of the mystery of the gospel. You know what a steward is? Steward's a tour guide. You know what it's not? A bouncer. In other words, what we're not is somebody standing at the door trying to decide who's on the list and who ain't on the list to come into this great celebration we got going on. Instead, we're grabbing everybody we can and bringing them in as a tour guide to just how vast this salvation is, just how great this rescue mission was. Woo! Hallelujah! That and a mistaken identity can end in one moment. Can end in one moment. Can absolutely end in one moment. And now you see yourself and you see others in such a way that you can actually enjoy people again. You actually can enjoy things. You can actually enjoy going out to eat with somebody. You can actually enjoy it no matter who it is, because you see that there's no one left out of what this man's doing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So he sat down, and the whole principle of his rule and throne is based on mankind returning to that innocence it had in the garden. Totally deleting the fall. Totally rebooting man. Because, you know, just as in the natural, man, you ever get a TV that has high definition to it, you don't want one that has standard. You know? You don't. Because you can see things you ain't never seen before. And some of them old programs that you just watched and looked at, you can go back and revisit them and you see a lot clearer now. Yeah. And see, that's what Jesus is. He's the high definition version of you. In other words, it had been there all along. We just couldn't see it. We just couldn't see it. Now we're seeing it in high definition. Why? Because you've not received the spirit of the world, but you've received the spirit of God, and the spirit searches all things, yea, even the deep things of God. Hallelujah. That means you're so compatible to spirit things. Remember we talked about that Sunday morning. Nicodemus, why do you even have an appetite to come out of all of that and ask me? You must be a man from God. God must be with you. What's drawing you out here? I tell you, because no one's ascended to heaven except for he's that descended from heaven. And guess what? Where I'm located right now, standing on the dirt road of Jerusalem, he says, I'm in heaven right now. So no matter where your feet take you, they cannot take you out of heaven. They cannot take heaven out of you. Yeah, I did not require nothing of you, says the Lord, but to stand and see the salvation I've provided. For I shall draw witness after witness after witness. They shall all see the glory of God together, says the Lord. And there'll be such an irresistible light shining that all the nations shall flow to the city of the Lord, says God. Hallelujah. Now you see why we have until now got to Ruth chapter 4. And you see why we might spend the rest of the year going to Ruth chapter 4. Do you understand? Because we're going to tie everything in together. But I want you to see that it wasn't him standing in the shadows. You ever notice someone posted something like this on Facebook the other day? It was a candle held up in light. There was a match. And the match had a flame on it that was burning. And you could see a shadow cast on the wall behind it. But guess what didn't have a shadow? The flame. The little stick for the match, you could see it, but the light had no shadow. You've been gotten by the Father of light.
in whom there is no variableness nor shadow of turning. Hallelujah.
Is that good news to y'all? Because that thing makes me want to kick one of them windows out.
And replace it next week. See this?
I honestly believe this is the gospel that shines in the light of it, that shines in the face of Jesus Christ. That can go into any darkness. Oh, I'll tell you. Me and Janelle have been watching this HBO series. I think it's called True Detective or something like that. And at the end of it, they had, I think it's Matthew McConaughey and Woody Harrelson. They're kind of the main detectives, actors in it. It is kind of a off-kilter thing, you know what I'm saying? But it was pretty neat. I mean, you kind of get caught up in it. But the end of it, Matthew McConaughey, he had a daughter that had got killed in a wreck. And at the end of it, you know, they're meeting this, you know, this killer guy, and he comes up and stabs him, you know, and so he's in the hospital, and he keeps saying, "I shouldn't have been here, I shouldn't have been here." He says that, you know, he's telling Woody Harrelson that in this time that he was in the hospital, there was a moment that he was in like this dark place, but he just absolutely felt the love of his daughter and his dad had passed away. He just knew that was totally embracing him. And all he had to do was let go, and he knew he could go just right into that. You know what I'm saying? And it not being interrupted. He's like, it felt like it had never been interrupted. And so he says, "I went to let go, and I let go, and I woke up." He was in a coma, and he woke up out of it. You know what I'm saying? And so they're talking, and he says, "Man, that's kind of a message within itself." You know what I mean? And because he always had these real philosophical things. You know what I'm saying? The man and religion, and you know what I mean, and stuff like that. And he said, "No, it shows me one thing, that there's only one story that's ever been forever." And he says it's light versus darkness. And so Woody Harrelson looks around and he looks up in the sky and he says, "Well," you know, he's thinking he's come around to the religious way of thinking, you know what I mean? He goes, "Well, from the looks of it up there, it looks like darkness is winning." Okay? And Matthew McConaughey doesn't say anything, and he's in a gurney, he's in a sheet, and he's in a wheelchair, and he tells him, "Man, get me out of this. I'm not going back in that hospital." You know? And they start walking away. And Matthew McConaughey says, "Marty, you're just looking at it all wrong." He says, "Because if it was all darkness to begin with, it looks like light is winning now." Yes. "Darkness covered the face of the deep," and he said, "It's all in the way you look at me." Yes. And me and Janelle, obviously, we just kind of cut our eyes at each other, and I was like, "Probably a sermon." Probably a sermon. Now, let's just read a couple more scriptures in 4, and we're gonna hush. He said, "Ho, such a one, turn aside, sit down here," and he turned aside and sat down. Now, who he's talking to is the law of sin and death. First come the law, then come grace. Everything's done in order. Okay? That's who he's saying. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city, automatically. 10 speaks of the 10 commandments, the law. What's he doing? The law and the prophets are going to witness this. Yes. And they're going to have to sign off on it. Yes. That whatever is demanded has been done.
Yes.
Whatever has been required. And could you get, can you see the picture? And we'll go in it farther down there when everybody's around there. Of that scene in Revelation where there's a numerous company of witnesses standing around the throne. This is what's happening. He's gathering all men in to see.
And the first one he's got to get the attention is the law and the prophets, because all the way through the law and the prophets, they were writing about you. So they're going to come and witness that everything that was required for your salvation, for your deliverance, has been done. Now I'll throw you this little nugget, because we're going to get in your safe. What was required in the transaction was an exchange of a sheep. According to Hebrew tradition, when there was a contract happening with redemption, one guy, the guy that was given up the property, had to take his shoe off and give it. So whoever had the shoe owned the whole deal. And it could not be taken away from. It could not be taken away from. So guess who's got the shoe tonight? Jesus. We'll get deep into this when we get there, but I want you to see something. That was not heaven crying, sobbing when Jesus is coming up Golgotha's hill. Because they know what's about to happen. They know that in the minds of them people, they think they're just killing the man. But they don't know they're fulfilling every scripture. And they don't understand that what they're about to do is release the glory of God in man. Because remember, in the pages of the Bible, history records the death of one man. But in the pages of eternity, recorded is the death of all mankind. He gave you a death. You didn't escape it. He gave it to you.
He had money for it.
Amen? So in that scene, that is death coming up with the sheep and giving it to Jesus, saying, now I no longer rule over. I no longer rule over man. I relinquish all rights to you and you alone. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for the time we've had to spend the last few services in this. I know you've quickened. I feel it in my spirit, and I feel it in everybody else's spirit. Now I thank you, Lord, that we know that it works, and it's at work in us, and we shall see and know this stuff experientially from now on, and we give you praise for it. Have you enjoyed yourself?
Amen.
Amen. There are times when I'll scream it at you, I will. But I've told you, I've been a lot softer lately. And it's okay. I'm all right with that. I'm all right with that. I want to see more than anything them aha moments in people's face. That's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for that moment when all of a sudden you go, oh, and then you'll never be the same again. Amen. God bless you. We'll be back Sunday morning.